Thank you all for coming out this evening. My name is Shamoon Zamir. I am an associate professor of literature and visual art at New York University. And I'm very, very happy to welcome you to this event organized by jointly by MEPI and the New York University Research Institute, which, as some of you know, undertakes many public events in the city. And it's my very great pleasure to introduce the evening and then later to moderate the discussion. As some of you probably know, this public event is tied to a workshop that will be taking place at New York University's downtown campus over the next few days, and a workshop that is organized under the heading of MEPI and is partly organized by the Arab Image Foundation in Beirut, and we are very glad to be hosting it this year round. I'm just going to introduce our two speakers and say a little bit about the Arab Image Foundation and the New York University's relationship with the Arab Image Foundation. Our two speakers tonight are Debra Norris and Nora Kennedy. Debra is chair of art conservation at the University of Delaware, and she's also a professor of photographic conservation. She's an extremely widely published scholar in her field and has had many honors and presentations and led many workshops around the world. Among her many achievements is the presidency of the American Institute for the Conservation of Historic and Artistic Works. And she has also served as the US Commissioner for UNESCO, and she'll be speaking first. Nora Kennedy is the Sherman Fairchild Conservator of Photographs at the Metropolitan Museum at New York. And she has in fact been one of the great pioneers of photographic conservation. She has been active in terms of organizing numerous exhibitions and educational programs at the Met. And she has been associated in fact with New York University's own Institute of Fine Arts in New York. She's the recipient of many awards and has been recognized in particular for her exceptional contribution to the field of conservation. The Arab Image Foundation, which is the organization that has been the driving force behind the MEPI event, is housed in Beirut, where it has been in operation since 1997. The Arab Image Foundation collects, preserves, and supports research in photographs from the Middle East and North Africa. It is a unique and quite exceptional foundation, a cultural organization in the world, really. And it's the only organization of its kind that I'm aware of with this kind of scope and ambition, which is developing very fast. Currently, it archives something around the region of 600,000 photographs. It has recently moved to a new building in Beirut, where it is trying to develop its programs in new ways. And the director of the Institute, Zaina Arida, is in the audience. We are very honored to have her here. Zaina has been the director of the Arab Image Foundation from its very start and has been one of the driving forces really developing the program of the foundation, but also its collaborations with many, many organizations, including, we are glad to say, recently, New York University. The collaboration with the Arab Image Foundation began a couple of years ago for us at NYU when I visited Beirut, because when I joined New York University at the start of the institution 3 years ago, one of the projects that we wanted to try and foster was research in and dissemination of research about the Arab photographic world, but also exhibitions, public events, and so on. And it was clear very quickly that the Arab Image Foundation would be a crucial partner for us. And we have worked together to develop a set of programs which we hope we will be able to unfold over the coming years, over a five-year period, working together to do a series of international colloquia and conferences which will lead to new research in this much neglected field of photographic history. And it is also our hope that this will lead to other unlooked-for collaborations. MEPI was one of these, which was a very fortunate event for us, and we are hoping for developing exhibitions together and so on. In fact, the ultimate ambition is, although it is so far only an ambition, is to establish a center for Arab photography at New York University in Abu Dhabi, which would be a kind of home for a series of different kinds of ongoing activities once New York University opens its new campus on Saadiyat Island. So I'm going to leave Nora Kennedy to introduce the MEPI project, because I know she has a few words to say about that. So it just remains for me to welcome our first speaker, Debra Norris. Please welcome Debra.
Thank you for that kind introduction. Thank you to NYU for partnering in this fantastic project that we are so excited to be involved in. And certainly, thank you to the Arab Image Foundation, who has partnered with Nora and I, and to the Getty Conservation Institute. These projects that really advance our understanding of the preservation of cultural heritage are accomplished through collaborations and partnerships. And this one is a real example, and you'll hear more about it from Nora. Most importantly, I suppose we also must thank the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, which is the primary funder for this initiative. And as you'll learn, it's a three-year project. We're into year two. Nora and I are going to be talking about photography, two different but very related topics. My presentation will focus on preservation of family photographs primarily. And so what I'd like to do is just talk a little bit about photography, why it's important, some of the different kinds of photographs that you're likely to encounter in your own family collections, and a few tips and areas of guidance on preservation of these materials. Now, according to the computer, I've already spoken for 29 minutes, and I only had 20. So I will have to quickly calculate in my mind what this means. Okay, I've got it. You know, you lose half of your brain when you're up at a podium sometimes. So you've got to start subtracting numbers and figuring it all out. Anyway, preservation of photographic heritage, and particularly, as I said, my comments will focus on the preservation of family photographs, the kinds of things that, of course, are enormously important and significant to all of us. And this is a photograph of my grandmother, Mina Hess, who was Norwegian heritage, and she loved coffee like I do. And grandma drank coffee all day long, and she died at 106. And so I always use her because a lot of my friends say, you drink too much coffee, it's not good for you. But grandma loved to drink coffee. And when I would go to visit her in the nursing home, she would always offer me coffee. And the other thing that she loved to do, of course, was to look at her family photographs. And even though she had short and long-term memory loss, she could pick up these albums and go through them and identify who this was and who that was. And it was always very special times. And these photographs, of course, bring back enormous memories to me. We understand these photographs, and we also understand that they are vulnerable to deterioration. And that they're valuable. They're valuable to all of us. Photography is so important in so many ways. And its value around the world is in areas of enhancing scholarship and knowledge, whether it's, in this case, early botanical specimens by Anna Atkins or important photographs of individuals. Of course, these materials inspire discourse in very significant ways. And they vary, as you can see, as you look at these images. They're all different in terms of their process, whether they're on glass or on metal, on paper or on film. They engage public audiences. They document our history. And of course, when we talk about family photographs, they're documenting the history of ourselves. And they connect cultures globally. And perhaps this is one of the most rewarding parts of the project that we're involved in now, is that it allows us all to work together in a very positive way. And as we work around the world preserving our global cultural heritage, whether it's photographic materials, ethnographic materials, archaeological materials, modern materials, it is that connection to people and to humanity that is the greatest reward for all of us. And of course, photographs allow us to celebrate greatness of all kinds. But they are endangered and they are deteriorating. And this slide just shows you an example of a whole variety of photographic printing processes, from early salted paper prints introduced in 1841 to more contemporary materials. And you can see that some of them have deteriorated, faded, yellowed, are abraded, are distorted in different ways. These are some of the physical and chemical problems that occur with photographic collections that we're working towards preserving, whether they're in collections, and Nora will talk more about preserving photographs in collections, particularly the Metropolitan Museum of Art, or in your own home in a family collection. And it's both the print materials and, of course, the negative materials that suffer from different kinds of catastrophic loss. In terms of photographic print materials from the 19th century, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in a moment, but here you see an albumen photograph. This is a process that dominates the 19th century. It's introduced in 1851. It's popular throughout the 19th century to about 1890, 1895. And in this case, with this photograph, you can see that it's begun to yellow and deteriorate. The silver image has begun to fade. And the best way to preserve these materials is to store them in a controlled environment. In your home, this might be using good quality enclosures, acid-free boxes, in an interior closet. And I'll talk more about that at the end. But these materials are fading, and you see it in your own collections, a silver gelatin black and white photograph that's been exposed to moisture, where in this case, the gelatin emulsion has begun to deteriorate. And gelatin is a nutrient for mold. So one thing that you're starting to see here is in these areas, the growth of mold. And we've been talking about this in the workshop. This is day one. We just finished day one. By the way, we have the most fantastic group of participants from 10 different countries throughout the Middle East. And it's been very rewarding. And we've been talking about some of the issues and challenges in general about the preservation of photographic materials. And I mentioned that, of course, now in the United States, we're dealing with the recovery of photographs that were damaged by Hurricane Sandy, which you probably heard about, this major, major storm that clobbered the East Coast. And people continue to, of course, struggle with the after effects, which were quite significant. In terms of collections, there's been considerable damage, not only to institutions and galleries, but in this case, to family collections. And as is true with all disasters, you see individuals going back to their homes to look for those family photographs to see what can be recovered and what can be saved, because that's what they really care about. Many other things can be replaced. And one of the challenges with Hurricane Sandy or any water-related damage are these black and white photographs where the binder layer is gelatin, because gelatin, when it gets wet, it swells and absorbs moisture. It can begin to stick to things, or as it dries out, you can begin to get the growth of mold. So these are some of the challenges. This is not this photograph in particular, but it represents some of the challenges that we're facing now in the recovery of these materials. And the message that we're trying to get out in that regard, in terms of family photographs, is to ensure that people don't throw these away, because they can be saved in many cases. They can be scanned. They can be preserved. But I think individuals in their despair just don't know what to do, who to turn to, and how individuals can help. So they're endangered from poor environmental conditions, and they're endangered from natural and man-made disasters. And photographic materials are also inherently unstable. That is, they can deteriorate even in a relatively good environment. An example would be the color photographs that you see here. With color photography, and color photography, of course, becomes popular, and you'll start to see it in your family collections by the 1940s, 1950s. It will begin to dominate your collections. In this case, these color photographs are comprised of organic dyes, magenta, cyan, and yellow. And these dyes fade at different rates. And so as these photographs begin to deteriorate, you can begin to lose, in this case, the cyan dye, the blue dye, leaving the magenta dye behind. And so the photograph appears very red, or some photographs in your homes may appear very blue or very cyan because the magenta dye has faded. Color photographs also have a tendency to yellow, and you can especially see this in the border. But this deterioration is inherent. We call it, in conservation, we sometimes call this inherent vice. And it simply means that these materials are inherently unstable. They require low temperature storage conditions to ensure their long-term preservation. And another example of this would be cellulose acetate negatives, which you see here. We're going to focus primarily on print materials and on positive materials, but you may have many negatives in your family collections as well. More likely they're on cellulose acetate base, or later, after 1950, on polyester base. But cellulose acetate as a material, as it deteriorates, as it's exposed to high relative humidity conditions, high temperature conditions, or fluctuating environmental conditions, it begins to shrink. And as it shrinks, the gelatin emulsion does not, and you get this sort of characteristic, what we call channeling or deterioration that you see here. In family collections, this is an issue. In institutions and libraries and archives, this is a catastrophe because they have so many of these negatives. And again, like color materials, these materials require cold storage, low temperature storage, to ensure their long-term preservation. When we talk about photographic materials and we focus on identification and differentiating these different materials, it's important just to think generically about what photographs are. You have a final image material, which is suspended in some kind of a transparent binder layer, coated on to a primary support. With some photographic printing papers, there's an additional layer on this primary support, which smooths it out. It's a white pigment barium sulfate. But generally, you have a layered structure as you see here. And this is true of all photographs, whether they're negatives or prints, early daguerreotypes, or contemporary color. And so in general, you have a support throughout the history of photography, which may be metal or glass or film or textiles or paper, a binder layer, which is that transparent material that holds the final image material in suspension. And throughout the history of photography, that may be albumen, which is the white of hen's eggs, collodion, which is a form of cellulose nitrate, or gelatin, which is a commercially prepared protein. All these materials interact and deteriorate in different ways. And in conservation and preservation, it's important to begin to differentiate these materials, understand them, so you can better predict how they will deteriorate and what you might do to preserve them. And then finally, the final image material. In the photographs that you treasure, this is the material that produces that image. And in most of the photographs that you're likely to have, it's probably silver, some form of metallic silver, whether it's produced by light or produced in a dark room. But photographs can also be comprised of platinum metal, of gold, of pigments, and of course, of dyes. And we spend a lot of time in conservation and in teaching talking about this cross-section so that we understand these materials and what they are and what we need to preserve them. And it's important with family collections as well. With family collections, you may be fortunate to have some very early direct positive photographic materials. One example is seen here. This is the daguerreotype. The daguerreotype is one of the earliest photographic processes. It was introduced in France in 1839. And it was popular, and these are dates from the United States, so they may vary, certainly in the Middle East. One thing we hope to do through the MEPI project is begin to develop a better understanding of the chronology of photographic processes in this part of the world. But generally, you see daguerreotypes from 1839, 1840, to about 1865. They're direct positive in that there is no negative. So these are made by taking a light-sensitive piece of silver-plated copper, placing it in a camera, and taking a photograph. The support, then, is silver-plated copper, and the image material is a silver-gold-mercury amalgam. They're typically in a case or framed on a wall, and they are fragile, and you need to be careful in handling them. They're protected by glazing and glass, and you want to leave them that way because the surfaces are very fragile and prone to damage from physical handling. They're also prone to, although this one is in very good condition, many daguerreotypes, if I go back, I think you'll see it here, begin to tarnish at their outer edges. So that's corrosion, silver corrosion, as you see with your own silver at home, or jewelry or whatever it is that you might have if you have anything that's made of silver. And it's occurring there because of the entrance of air and moisture. So air and moisture is accelerating the deterioration of this daguerreotype plate, as you see here. Now, another example of a direct positive process, again, direct positive refers to the fact that there is no negative, so these are one of a kind, is the tintype or the ferrotype. Tintype or ferrotype is introduced around 1856 and popular throughout the 19th century. And these can be found loose, as you see here, or they might be in decorative paper mats. They might be in photographic albums. Sometimes you find them in jewelry. You might also find them framed or in miniature cases like the daguerreotype. But they're different from a daguerreotype in that the support is not silver-plated copper, but rather iron. And as you can see here, one of the problems with iron is that it rusts. And so one of our greatest challenges with the preservation of tintypes or ferrotypes is to try and mitigate against this deterioration of the primary support. Again, you know, rust is caused by exposure to high relative humidity. So much of the work that we do is focused on controlling, monitoring, and controlling the environment. So the tintype is introduced in 1856. It's popular throughout the 19th century. It's on an iron support that's coated with a black lacquer. That's what the japanning is. And in this case, it is a silver image embedded in a collodion binder layer and typically varnished. And the varnish protects that silver image from oxidation and deterioration, as you saw at the outer edges of the daguerreotype. And therefore, many tintypes are in generally good condition because they've been varnished, so that protects the image from fading and deterioration. They are often hand-colored in the cheeks with a little bit of red pigment to make the individuals appear more lifelike. So again, you may have daguerreotypes and you may have tintypes if you have very early materials in your family collections. Print materials include a variety of materials, such as the salted paper process, which you see here. This is one of the earliest photographs on paper. This is a silver image in a paper support, or the albumen process, which is a photographic process that dominates the 19th century, which is made, again, as I mentioned earlier, from the whites of hen's eggs in a silver image. In this case, this beautiful portrait is extensively hand-colored. And you see this a lot, and you'll see it in your family photographs as well, that early photography was often hand-colored to make people appear more lifelike. Photography was fantastic, but it is monochromatic. And so individuals worked from the very beginning to discover and to identify ways to hand-color them effectively. Throughout the history of photography, the processes evolve and change. And we don't have time to talk about all these, but it's important to have a chronology in your mind when you're looking at your family photographs. And just to simply recognize that the earliest processes are salted paper, you're less likely to have them in your family collections, but you may very well have albumen prints, because these dominated the 19th century. So as you can see in the dates here, from 1855 to 1890 are dates of popularity, really around the world. And so if you have early images, they may in fact be albumen. There are a whole group of different printing out papers made with gelatin and collodion at the turn of the century. And then by 1905, you see the introduction or the popularity of black and white silver gelatin papers until the 1960s, when contemporary color dominates the kinds of materials that you're likely to have. Now, in terms of print materials, let me just say a few words about albumen and silver gelatin. And then I'll soon turn this over to Nora. But the albumen process, again introduced in 1851, dominates the 19th century. These photographs are made on a very thin paper support, but they're typically mounted in some way, as you see here. The final image material is silver, embedded in this egg white binder. And these materials can fade and deteriorate. And this fading, just like the other materials we talked about, is accelerated by exposure to high relative humidity conditions, fluctuating environmental conditions, pollutants in the air. Many albumen prints look more like this. This particular photograph is much more faded and deteriorated, more yellowed than the photograph before it. But they're both albumen prints. And this is more typical of the albumen prints that we encounter really around the world. When you look at these materials under magnification, you may, in fact, begin to see this characteristic cracking that you see with albumen prints, as that egg white binder, which is coated on the thin paper support, expands and contracts differently upon exposure to fluctuating environmental conditions. In comparison, your family photographs from the 20th century, certainly up until 1950, are likely to be black and white silver gelatin materials, as you see here. They look very different from the albumen print. I don't have time to sort of get into the technology, But they're made in a slightly different way. These are made in a dark room through chemical enlargement. The albumin print is a printing out process where that light sensitive paper is placed in contact with a negative and placed out into the sun where it prints out. Both these images are comprised of metallic silver, but silver that's produced in a very different way. Like the albumin print, these materials are susceptible to deterioration and oxidation and fading, or in this case, silver mirroring, caused by exposure to poor environmental conditions, and also caused by housing in poor quality materials, cardboard and things that give off pollutants that will affect the silver image, causing it to deteriorate, as you see here. And finally, chromogenic color photographs, again, as I've already mentioned, are dye-based images. They're based on the light sensitivity of silver halides, but the final image is actually a dye or a series of dyes, magenta, cyan, and yellow, and these materials fade in the dark and they fade in the light. And therefore, the only way to ensure their long-term preservation is low temperature storage, which is not so easy. It's difficult for an institution. It's very difficult if you have a collection of family materials. And one thing you don't want to do, this happens all the time when you give public lectures, is don't go home and put your photographs in the freezer, because freezers cycle in terms of the relative humidity. You can actually cause them all to stick together. I have had this happen. I've had people who've called me like days later and said, I just don't want my photographs. I put them next to the ice cream in a special Ziploc bag. It's like, oh my God, what have I done? So don't do that. We're not going to talk about negative materials necessarily, but of course these represent a large portion of photographs that you're likely to have. And as is true with all materials, one of the most important things for you to think about is proper handling. Be sure that these materials are handled properly, whether they're in a museum, a library, archive, or in your home. Don't handle them directly. Use gloves. Many of these materials are very fragile, and they can be damaged. And some of you may be fortunate to have photographic albums, which are real treasures, and looking through those albums with my grandmother. It's all about the chronology. It's about who put it together. It's about the inscriptions and what they say. And so this is very important as well. So finally, just a couple of tips on preservation, and Nora and I and others in the audience actually would be happy to answer any questions that you have at the end of this session. But you want to try and always house your photographic materials in good quality enclosures, which may be plastic or paper, and box to give them a little bit more protection from air and moisture. And then perhaps housed in an interior closet of some kind, not in your attics or in areas that are exposed to higher temperatures and higher relative humidity. There are a variety of different plastics and paper enclosures that are available. And Nora will also mention a new brochure that's been developed thanks to TrueView Incorporated and their support, which has information on proper housing and storage of photographic materials that I think might be very useful to all of you. So housing materials in good quality enclosures is important. Storing photographs in interior closets where the environments are less likely to fluctuate, because again, so much of this deterioration is driven by the environment. Controlling the temperature and relative humidity as much as possible. Certainly always being willing to seek advice. There are many individuals who are happy to help, to provide advice online or in person, local museums, local libraries, local archives, private individuals, and of course the Arab Image Foundation, which is so unique and so special, not just for the Middle East, but really for the world. It is one amazing and exceptional organization, and you can turn to them for advice on preservation of your photographic heritage, and I urge you to do that. And to be sure that your collections are secured against emergencies. Of course, these are catastrophic in museums, libraries, and archives, but they're equally, if not more so, in your own home. So what can you do to protect these collections from potential disasters, housing them in watertight containers, for example, if you're worried about a flood? You need to sort of think about what are the threats and what can you do to protect them. And always handle them carefully to avoid physical damage. You may want to think carefully about exhibition of these materials. You might want to display in your own home facsimiles and copies and preserve the originals, which you can do. That's more difficult in a museum where they really want to display the original, but that's a solution. And certainly with digital imaging and everything that's available, you can make these copies available to other members of your family. So those are just some tips. I want to thank you for your attention. I'm going to turn this over to Nora, who's going to talk more about photographs in an institutional environment. Thank you.
It's really terrific to be here. This is my first trip to Abu Dhabi. I was born in the Middle East. I was born in Beirut and Lebanon. Grew up there. My parents worked at the American University of Beirut, so I always love coming back. But Abu Dhabi is a new experience, I have to say. I'm really very, very impressed. So Debbie has been speaking about all the variety of materials involved in making up photographs and also in the care of family collections. What I'll be looking at really is art, photography as art. And because I work at the Metropolitan Museum in New York, I will be looking at the photographs from that collection, though of course it could be a library, an archive, or many museums around the world. The role of photography is varied. There are photographs that exist as documentation, photographs related to collections, and then also the fine art photographs. And I'll give you a few examples of each of these coming up. This is the photograph studio as it used to look in the Metropolitan Museum. You see here the domes. For those of you who have visited the museum, when you enter the Great Hall and you look up, there are domes above you. The photographers, next time you go there, you can imagine this beehive above the domes where the photographers work. In those days, of course, they were using the natural light from the skylight, and you can see some of this old equipment. Nowadays, things don't look quite as romantic. The photographers are using, this is a scanning bag here that Joe has. There's the artwork, and everything's connected with wires to the laptop. But the images that the photograph studio at the Met creates, documenting the collections, whether smaller items like this one, or larger architectural pieces, the Temple of Dendur, they're really of a phenomenally high quality. So these are photographs that exist in the museum that document the history of acquisitions, of buildings, of projects, of staff. And now, of course, it's 100% digital, but there is a large collection of negatives from going from negatives on glass all the way up through a variety of different plastics. The Metropolitan also has 17 curatorial departments, and each of these really does have photographs of one kind or another. I've made this slide so that the departments that are a bit lighter in color, those are the ones that have more photographs, or at least come to us for more assistance with their photographs. So for example, this is an image from the Asian Art Department, and this one from Costume Institute. My primary responsibility is to the Department of Photographs that has the fine art photographs. But I do want to show you some images from other collections. This from the Curatorial Department of the Arts of Africa, Oceania, and the Americas, all grouped together. This is called an archive, and it tends to have photographs that relate somehow to the artworks in the collection. Here you see spirit boards, some of which we do have in our collection, but I think you'll agree with me, this is only a 35 millimeter slide, but I think it's really a beautiful image. In this case, this is also in AAOA's collection, and this without question is an artwork by a well-known artist, Seydou Keita. At some point I asked the archivist, you know, excuse me, how did you, what's the excuse for acquiring this one? This is a work of art and it's in your archive. And she said, the textiles. And it does indeed, it does represent not only a variety of textiles, but the use of those textiles. And it's a great image. I couldn't argue with her. And now I'll give you a little bit of an outline, show you some images from the Department of Photographs, from the Fine Art Collection. Our collection spans the entire history of photography from very, very early experiments. What you see here is an experiment, an image by Hippolyte Bayard, the Frenchman, one of the unsung inventors of photography. And it's true, it doesn't look like much. You can see some windmills here, but the image is not, at least now, is not so very distinct. And it's more of value for its artifactual importance. But we also have things like this double piece from the Reading depicting the Reading establishment and attributed to William Henry Fox Talbot and Nicholas Henneman. Talbot, of course, one of the inventors of photography on paper, as well as images on the sort of competing process of the daguerreotype that Debbie already mentioned, the invention of daguerre. This, interestingly enough, it's an unknown portrait, but of a very, very famous man in American history, Frederick Douglass. Moving on into the 19th century, we have albumen prints, as Debbie mentioned, the process that really dominates the century, this one by Lewis Carroll. And in theory, we boast at the Metropolitan not only artwork spanning the entire history of every media, but also from every geographic region in the world. I have to say that we're rather North America and Europe centric. And we do have a few Iranian photographs. We have some other photographs from the Middle East, from Asia, from Africa. But we are very weak in this area, and that's something that we're trying to work to overcome. As we move into the 20th century, color arrives. This is a wonderful image of these guys. I show it partly because Debbie loves it. It's called the Coffee Drinkers. I love it too because it's an advertisement, but I can never figure out what for. Anyway, and this is one process that is pigment-based, so it's incredibly stable. So these guys in their lovely aprons and neckties are as colorful now as they were when this image was first created. As we move forward, then this is a piece by Paul Strand, entering into the modernist period, this Lux Feininger gelatin silver developed out photograph. And then we move into full-scale color. This one by Richard Prince has had a lot of press. And as Debbie mentioned, these are dye-based images, so they do present some challenges for an art museum where exhibition is really one of our primary reasons for being. Another color image, this one by contemporary artist Jim Welling. We also have holdings in the Department of Photographs in what we call time-based media. This is an example here, Jennifer and Kevin McCoy, every shot, every episode. And it consists of a number of CDs and this actually really, the artists have omitted very cheap video CD player. And again, this type of material offers incredible challenges to conservators. It tends to fall in the lap of photograph conservators, although I always try to just pitch it back out again. And I work on the preservation of these materials with some of our colleagues in the digital media department because they are so different than photographs. It's a matter of looking not so much as the object, as the be-all and end-all, but as the data, as something that you can't see, and that you in fact need to, you have to, you must migrate forward as the technology advances, or you will lose it. So in this case, for example, Jennifer and Kevin have said they want the look of this. This is actually what hangs on the wall, but if the time comes when this player will not play the CDs anymore, we're allowed to feed a wire in the back and pretend that it's playing it. So they have accepted that. This is just another representation of a Maria Marshall piece that actually it's on view now at the Met. When I grew up, I want to be a cooker. And I find this, it's a very short piece. It's on a loop. And it's both incredibly beautiful and also intensely disturbing. It's this beautiful young boy smoking a cigarette. And I assure you, this is not real. It was a candy cigarette, and then she added in the little tendrils of smoke and the glowing coals at the end of the cigarette. But it's really lovely and also disturbing, as I said. Now, photograph conservation at the Met has the responsibility, very similar, really, to people caring for their family photographs. This is our lab. This is our lab when we first moved into it in 2001. It looks a lot more cluttered now. It looked very clean and empty at the time, but we're very busy. We're very active. We do a lot of work. So as Debbie mentioned, preservation includes things like making sure that photographs are well housed, that they're housed in good quality materials. In an art museum, that might be something like this, a window mat and a mount, which might not be appropriate for a family collection, but you know, it would certainly for special photographs. And also for more archival collections or documentary collections, housings in plastic sleeves, within folders, and so on. It also means placing those nicely housed photographs in the best storage that you can manage. We still have some work to do on that at the Met. This looks very nice, and the temperature is controlled. Indeed, the humidity is controlled. And we do have a cool storage vault up in the photograph studio that houses the negatives there. So ideally, you do want to keep that environment under control. And quite honestly, the preservation work is not exciting or glamorous, but it is the most important thing that we do. It addresses the needs of the entire collection. We also do get involved in conservation treatment. I will say that our collection is in very good condition, so we don't get to do treatments like this where there's a bit of surgery to reconstruct the foot. We don't get to do this very often. One thing that maybe is different than preserving family photographs, as I mentioned, we're an art museum. We have a mandate to do exhibitions. And we have, at the moment, three galleries that are devoted to the exhibition of photographs, the Gilman Gallery, the Joyce and Robert Menschel Gallery, and the Johnson Gallery. In addition to that, of course, we also have special exhibition galleries, and at the moment, this is an older slide, but at the moment we have an exhibition called Faking It, which I strongly recommend. You can go online and play a game on Faking It, but it's about the manipulation of photography before Photoshop. So things like collage, hand coloring, retouching, from all different aspects. The curator is Mia Feynman. It's extraordinarily well done. I realized at some point that Debbie and I we share slides. So here, Richard, you know, what do? You have to exhibit things. Some things are sensitive to light exposure, color materials in particular. What do you do? One thing is to control the light levels. Make sure that they're not so bright. If they are, turn them down a little or shorten the exhibition time and replace that photograph with a different image. We're also very involved in strategies toward exhibition, such as you see here, two of our research scholars, Katie Sanderson here, who is taking measurements on a photograph to determine what color it is before the exhibition and then what color it is after the exhibition. And hopefully those numbers are exactly the same. In many cases, in fact, they are. Luisa Casella did an experiment with anoxic environments, with creating environments for photographs and pulling out all the oxygen, and did in fact determine that can be beneficial for some types of photographs when exhibiting. Now, when we come to contemporary art, for example, like this Jeff Wall, sometimes there are factors that are out of our control. There are complications always. I mean, the first is that these are large works of art. The Jeff Wall comes with its own gigantic light box. So you have to put that together and put the bulbs in. Then you have to get a bunch of guys to help you put it up on the wall. Then you hang the transparency on top of that. And basically, the light from that light box is the light that exhibits that photograph. So you really have very little control over those light levels. You can modify them somewhat, but not a great deal. Jeff, of course, knew this when he created this work, and he chose a color process, the silver dye bleach process, that was most stable under those types of conditions. Another artwork that we recently installed and had up for about 7 months and then recently de-installed is this piece by Francesca Woodman called The Temple Project. And The Temple. It looks very sort of innocent and calm lying flat on its back here. But just to give you an idea of what went into getting this thing on the wall, we had to create a rigid support for it, a very large rigid support. We covered that with paper. We then unrolled the photograph onto that, put a nice decorative border around the edges, and then taped that down as well to the support. So this thing was secured to this giant aluminum panel with a series of earth magnets up at the top, hinges here, hinges there. It was really an engineering feat. And then, again, with the help of our wonderful riggers, our electricians, our carpenters, we had to call a lot of shops together to help out. This went up and up and up. Hey, there it is. That was a big moment. It didn't fall down, yay. Let me turn now from the Metropolitan Museum and talk a little bit about the MEPI project, about the Middle East Photograph Preservation Initiative. You've heard a little bit already. This is an incredibly exciting project to be involved in. As Debbie mentioned, this is our second year of the three-year project. I'll go through some of the goals. Wow, that is pixelated. Sorry about that. Looks better on my screen. Sorry. The goals: raise awareness of the importance of photograph collections, develop a directory of photograph collections that can be accessed online internationally, build a network of professionals, make sure that everyone who is caring for collections gets to know one another, and of course, improve the preservation of photographs. I do want to insert here, just to make sure that I do not forget this, that there are a number of partners. As Debbie said, everything we do goes much better with a strong group of partners who are collaborating, working together. So the Arab Image Foundation, first and foremost, University of Delaware, Metropolitan Museum, Getty Conservation Institute are partners in this endeavor, and then the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, who has provided funding for some portions of it. What is our methodology? Our methodology begins with a survey of collections throughout the Middle East. We then have these three courses, and we'll conclude with a symposium. And let me just go over these a little bit one by one. So the collection survey, it's been discussed a little bit with these three researchers in three different regions, looking, basically seeking out collections, trying to find the collections. As one might expect, there are many, many individuals throughout the Middle East who care deeply and passionately about the history of photography, the importance and value of photography, but sometimes it's hard to find them. And one of our goals is really to locate people and connect them with one another. The first MEPI course took place in Beirut in 2011. I'm showing this group shot because we just had our first day with our participants, so we haven't had a chance to do the group picture yet. But do you all want to stand up? No. They're kind of over there and a few over here. Yeah. No, it's a lovely group already. These courses have three parts. We begin with a workshop, and again, Debbie, you've seen this picture before. We begin with a workshop, and then that's followed by 8 months of long-distance mentoring via the internet. And then at the conclusion, we meet again. We all come together again so that we can talk about what has been accomplished. The workshops have both lectures and practica, and importantly, visits to collections. And we'll be visiting collections here in the region tomorrow, and I forget, on other days during the workshop. This is the American University of Beirut Jaffet Library Special Collections that I'm showing here. Again, I could probably talk for 3 hours about the MEPI, so I'm really cutting this short. But please, if you do have questions, Debbie and I would be happy, and everyone else in the audience, Zena and Rima would be happy to answer questions. The distance mentoring phase, a really, really important component of the course, and one that has been brought to the venture by the Getty Conservation Institute. The participants are given certain assignments. This one was to share the information that they had learned through MEPI, either in a public setting or in a more intimate setting with staff. Some of the participants in the past chose to write an article or set up a blog. It can be done in a number of different ways. Other projects included taking your collection, having a look at how it's housed, and then perhaps making improvements to those housings. Other projects included learning about how to take temperature and relative humidity readings, how to monitor the environment, and then once you get this, to learn what does this mean? You know, is this good? What does this mean? And what should I do about it? And in many cases, people were really able to make improvements to the storage conditions for their collections. The follow-up meeting, I've got to say, was fantastic. It was held in Rabat, hosted by the National Library, and there was such energy and enthusiasm. The participants who had befriended one another on Facebook and had really gotten so much done in the interim. I think all of us were floored by the dedication, the creativity, a lot of different approaches to different problems, and just, I mean, the camaraderie was just phenomenal. We had some lectures just going over points that seemed to be unclear, and there was a great session that Bertrand Lavedrine, one of our professors who's in the audience here, led on some just simple chemical tests to identify materials that might not be the best to use for preserving your photographs. And then there was the happy moment when everyone got their certificates of participation. You can see this is a great group here. MEPI is moving forward. We're beginning our second year. We have another one to go. There'll be a symposium at the end, but I think some of us were already talking about what else. What else do we need to do to raise awareness of the importance of photography in the region, to help with advocacy, with fundraising, and so on. And be very, very interested to hear what all of you have to say, to hear your thoughts. One of the most important things of all is building this network, people getting to know one another. And we don't want to have one group and then the second group and then the third group. We're trying to make sure that people really get to know each other throughout the three courses. And we're doing that, for example, by having a mentoring program. Program is overstating it, where participants from the first course are mentoring participants from the second course, just giving advice, providing sources for materials, whatever it might be, formal, informal. And in addition, of course, there's this symposium that we hope to have at the end. So that concludes my comments. I think we move now to the panel. And again, we're very, very interested to hear who you all are and your interest in photography and any thoughts you might have. Thank you.
Question, could you tell us a bit more about the survey that was done at the front, first part of the initiative in terms of collections in the region and what it uncovered?
Do you guys want to address
that? Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I'll start, but if you want to jump in, please. We hired three researchers and they covered different parts of the region. Finding the collections was interesting. I mean, some were already connected with some collections, and by word of mouth, you hear about others. There was also research, looking in books, looking at the credits, and so on. And then contact was made, preferably in person. That's always the best. But if not in person, then by email, by telephone, by whatever means. We had a survey form that provided just very basic information, like how many photographs do you have? Are they 19th century, 20th century? Well, there were dates, negatives, positives, color, that type of thing. Do you have funding? Do you have staff members? And the idea ultimately is to get it, the information online. We thought it would be great to have a site where you could go and find collections in your region or collections with certain holdings. I think we would start probably with just some basic information, contact information, maybe a few images, maybe low resolution, if copyright is an issue. But just to be able to enable people to connect with one another.
If I can add the importance of the survey also, because we did a pilot project, first workshop in 2009 that was supported by the Getty. And at that time, the foundation was already working for some time in the region. So we were in contact with some photographic collections, but it was very difficult to reach out and invite the right people to attend the first workshop because we actually didn't know so many collections. And the survey helped us, after the survey, which helped us locate 250 institutions, photographic collections, mainly part of non-private collections. Private collections are important because very often it contains culturally very important collections, but the aim is also to help preserve collections that are accessible to the public. So we were able, the first year after the survey, we had 42 applicants for the workshop, and this year 60. So this means that we were able to send much, to reach out to much more institutions who could benefit from the workshop.
And we are, we're, Beirut was the host site for the first workshop, Rabat was the site for the follow-up. Now we're in Abu Dhabi. We don't know where the next follow-up is, but the idea is to move around so that the participants can visit collections, to get to know other collections, to know also that a lot of the problems they face are actually very common. Other people are facing them too. It's nothing to be ashamed or embarrassed about. And there are solutions that we can work on together.
I think if I just add one other thought, it's all about building capacity as well. And one thing that's so, when you look around the world and look at the challenges that are facing photographic collections, whether they're in China or Latin America or in the Middle East, the challenges are very similar. The way these materials deteriorate is very much the same. And we hope that this, in fact, will serve as a model for other parts of the world. We're very fortunate to have the Arab Image Foundation here to serve as a cornerstone for this initiative, to take it on, to be the resource of information and sharing and promoting and building capacity. And our next challenge, I hope, is to look at Africa and to think of what can we do in that part, in Sub-Sahara, in West Africa, in Central Africa, to reach out to those institutions which are struggling with some of the same problems. But how do we get that going? How do we move forward? But this can serve as a model in doing that in other parts of the world as well.
I just wanted to maybe
highlight a little bit that all these old photographies, they have been always cherished, and it was, let's say, limited amount of those photographies. Since we started to have digital cameras and also scanners and so on, I would highly welcome and recommend to have, let's say, addition how to preserve the digital photography, because on one hand side, it looks okay, it doesn't deteriorate, but it's so easy to just delete them, or it is so easy to make a DVD or a CD, which after a few years actually doesn't work at all. Then you have the, you know, the hard disks, which also doesn't work after some time. So, and maybe one more information is that, again, you had limited amount of photographies in the past, and people cherish them. Now you will have maybe thousands or couple of or hundreds of thousands of photographies, from where you have a few which are just super great, but they are part of the huge collection which is maybe not so great. Then it's so easy just to lose this great photo that you would really like to find, and you cannot find it, or it's deleted, or it is just wasted. So I would just like to invite this for future.
No, you're absolutely right.
Thank you.
And there are a couple of additional thoughts that I would contribute also. The fact that the digital revolution has taken over so quickly and so completely means that those photographs that are still out there have become more precious and more valuable. So we do need to focus on preserving them. But the interesting thing is that doing collection surveys now, you look at the digital first. The last things that were acquired are the first things you look at, because those are the ones that are most in need of a preservation plan. And as you say, the time period is, it's 3 years, it's 5 years, it's not long at all before things drop out, before things are damaged, before they can't be read anymore. And I think that's something, sometimes people think scanning their collections is a preservation tool. No, it's not. It's not. It's an access tool, and there's nothing like it. It's nothing beats it in terms of access. But in fact, preserving those images is time-consuming and expensive, and it's relentless. It will go on forever. You really have to be paying attention with digital images.
I think it's, when you talk about family photographs, this is the major challenge, and you're absolutely right. Because when you speak to your colleagues who are photographing weddings or whatever it is, it doesn't even dawn on them that these materials aren't going to last forever. And they're just storing them on their computers or on their iPhones or wherever it might be. And so it is a major, major challenge. Within the workshop, we do spend 2 days that are going to be focused on digital imaging and the issues of the preservation of digital files. But you're absolutely right that in these kinds of forums, we should be doing more of that as well. I avoid it completely. I sort of draw the line at 1990. But I can't do that. And it is everywhere. And that is the real concern of individuals. I mean, every single event that you go to, everyone's got cameras and they're all digital.
I would encourage you, those of you, well, everybody takes digital photographs though. But if there are images that are really important to you, print them out. And try to print them out in whatever is at that moment the best media combination.
Then put it in a watertight box in the closet and never open it.
You don't know how many boxes I have in my closet. I have no room for other things with pictures. But from my experience, and correct me, or I would like to hear what you have to say, that if I prepare an album, let's say for my grandchildren or my children, you know, my grandchildren are not interested in me when I was little. That's very boring. What they like is pictures of themselves, of their daily life. And their children as well. I don't think it will ever go I don't want to say that. I don't think it goes beyond three generations, the interest in these pictures.
I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there are individual cases. I have a feeling, though, that maybe they're not interested now, but they will be. Sometimes as people grow older, they realize, oh my goodness, I need to talk with this person. I need to know about what their life was then, and I want to see what they looked like and what they were wearing and what they were doing. It's probably not true in all cases.
I will say that the greatest tragedy for conservators is when you're presented with boxes of photographs where individuals have just found them in the attics or basements or closets, and they have no idea who those individuals are. And they're sort of struggling with, should I keep this or should I not? I just had a woman who came in our graduate program. We have a once a month free of charge conservation clinic. And so she brought in all these materials to donate to the program because she didn't know who anyone was, or so she thought. But as we started going through them, there were inscriptions and all kinds of things and associated materials. It was unbelievable what she had. And so she called me back and she said, you know, I've decided to keep all this. I'm going to spend some time going through it and trying to coordinate it and document it. So it is so important to take that time now to document who those individuals are and to inspire the next generation to sort of care for these materials. I think, in fact, I'm an optimist, but they will. But when they end up with boxes where no one's identified, then they really don't know what to do. They know these are relatives, but they don't know who they are. Mm-hmm. So spending time like I did with grandma, with albums and writing down notes and those kinds of things is such a fantastic experience, but also so important for future generations.
I suspect the same is true at the national level, that there are nations that go through phases of wanting certain kinds of photographs and then realizing much later that they should have preserved other kinds of national archives. I suspect that's a real issue exactly where we are sitting right now. That as this nation develops as a very young nation, there are real decisions to be made about what is being preserved and what isn't being preserved. There are certain things which I think are very high up in the national psyche right now because of the particular phase of history that this nation is going through. But it may be in 30 years' time people decide that there was a whole other phase of history that should have been preserved and that nobody did it. And I think one of the things that, you know, this kind of event, collaborating with the Arab Image Foundation, the kinds of programs that the local universities are developing, I know at Zayed at NYU, are beginning to address that kind of issue. And I think that's really, really important. Because what the institutions, the academic institutions and the intellectuals are banking on is that there are all kinds of stories to be told, which may return as central areas of interest 30 years from now, but maybe not tomorrow.
I'd like to go back to a question about digital archives. What are your thoughts or tips about keeping an archive readable? Because as we discussed, software is updated literally by the month, and things become outdated very quickly. So if one is currently working with a digital archive, how do you keep it so that it will be able to be readable and searchable just in, say, five or 10 years' time?
Do you like to address that?
No. It's a very important question.
This isn't either of our expertise, but in general, you have to exercise the files, believe it or not, which means open them, you know, make sure they're still opening, and then you have to migrate things forward. As the technology changes, you have to migrate things forward. Be sure you have backups. Be sure you have them on servers or external hard drives, and be sure you have a couple of backups. Debbie arrived here with a computer whose fan didn't work and was essentially a piece of plastic with some...
And it's been a tragedy ever since.
So she couldn't access her talk. She couldn't access anything. It's a miracle that she was...
Alive.
Up here at all. But that's that type of catastrophic thing.
Problems.
You know, you pull the plug and there's nothing there.
I believe the British Museum is migrating every 4 years to a new system.
There are best practices, and there may be anyone in the audience who's involved in this who has expertise in terms of digital asset management.
I mean, the Met backs up every night, and then every week tapes are sent off-site. It's crazy, right? It's a phenomenal expense. We can't live without it, though, either. I mean, we're so dependent on it.
How about our colleagues who are here from MEPI, from institutions? Do you have anything to add to that? Yeah. You need that mic, I think.
Can you get the mic down there?
There it is. Behind. Here it comes.
Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah, the migration to new formats, it's what now the conservators will do. But what has to be discussed is to find one format and standardize everything. And this format should be open source. And all that.
Yeah.
They're discussing that, and maybe the DNG would be the perfect format. And that will be let's say, forever. So even if they update Photoshop or whatever, this format will be always readable. It's a sort of PDF. PDF is owned by Adobe too. So that's the solution is there. It's just to find a standardized open source format.
I also want to add that we talked about albums and talk with your grandmother and get information. In the digital world, metadata. Metadata.
I just want to add maybe one thing. Okay, formats and so on is important, but in general, as a tip maybe, some of my friends would be doing this, that you will have maybe one of your master backup or something at home, mm-hmm. but you will make a copy of it, another backup, and you will actually place it whatever in a summer house or at your grandma's place or somewhere else. Yes. And that is with this floods or the fires or other things like this. And then, of course, you have the clouds now. The problem with the clouds or with, you know, the online services is that actually you don't have too much control out of it. And then you don't really want to send some of your maybe sensitive photographs. So there are a lot of issues with it. So that's why it was my recommendation to bring it up in future more.
I wanted to actually ask both of you, since you had experience working with the Arab Image Foundation and in the region, are there issues about to do with preservation and collections which are not just general but specific to the region that really stand out, or
is your conflict?
Yeah.
No, I mean it's true. Armed conflict. I'm afraid that's something that when we did the workshop in Beirut, Debbie and I have experience with fire and flood, but we don't have a lot of experience with, you know, I might get shelled, I might get bombed, where do I take my collection? And so participants were able to contribute. I mean, some had actually very sophisticated emergency plans set up, unfortunately, because they had a lot of practice with that.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to add that, for instance, in Lebanon, throughout another project that is related to the preservation of modern cultural heritage, we have realized that none of our institutions, including us, has already a disaster plan. So we are now working on doing a kind of pilot project of a disaster plan with the Arab Image Foundation and the Fouad Debbas collection. And to, you know, in the idea of helping other institutions to do their own disaster plan. So disaster plan, normally, if you follow methodologies that are available, do not include war or this kind of scenarios. But in our case, well, we are including it and adapting to possible situations.
We have developed, and I don't know, Zain, if it's available, the disaster wheel. Is that hard for people to get? Because that's all translated now in English and Arabic and many other languages.
Yes, we brought some actually with us here, and we will be distributing it through our local partners and the institutions who are participating.
This is a wheel that identifies what you need to do to respond to man-made and natural disasters within the first 48 hours for all kinds of materials, not just photographic, but electronic media. Ethnographic, archaeological, paintings, textiles, etc. It's really a great resource. And another difference, I would say, is just in some parts of the Middle East is the arid, dry, dusty problems that are associated with care and preservation. So it's something that we don't always encounter. So the environment, particularly the arid environment, certainly is a challenge. And yet, and another difference, is there seems to be many very, very significant collections in private hands, and trying to identify where those collections are, which gets back to the fundamentals of MEPI, was really important, so that we had a sense many of these collections were hidden or no longer in various countries. So identifying them was perhaps more of a challenge here.
You had showed earlier a Jeff Wald image. With preservation in a contemporary image like that, is the artist involved in it themselves? And if so, does that, what sort of copyright issues you have with that, and what control does he then have over how it's represented, given that his work is very much about the presentation or the performance of the piece when it's displayed?
Yeah. No, Jeff is, he's been very, very much involved in the preservation of his work all along. And in fact, for a couple of the installations, we hired one of his assistants to come because it's a complicated installation. And it was just reassuring to have somebody there who had done it repeatedly and knew which steps to take and how to address any issues. Jeff, his policy is that he will make another print. This is an interesting issue. His policy is that he will make another print. If ours fades to the point where it's no longer acceptable, and one can ask, how does one know when it's no longer acceptable? He will replace that print.
But that's reliant on him being alive, so 20 years, 30 years.
Yes, there are a number of questions here. That relies on him being alive, number one, and making the judgment that, you know, this is the print. Number two, photographic materials. Right? Silver dye bleach in that format. We better make those prints fast, is my feeling, because they're not going to be available much longer. And at the moment, I don't believe there are any really good, maybe I'm wrong about this, but really good digital print color transparency alternatives. There will be, I'm sure there will be, but I'm not sure there are right now.
Jumping back to the digital, in your opinion, to save something that we consider a very precious photo or photos of an event, should we save it on the SIM card of our iPhone? Should we put it onto a hard disk, an external hard disk, a CD, a DVD, or a flash drive? What would be your opinion of the best way to preserve some photos?
Well, again, we're not the experts, but I think given those options, I would go with an external hard drive. But maybe I would go for two external hard drives. And again, don't think of it as something that you then put in the closet. You have to put it on the calendar again in a few years. You have to keep looking at the files, keep using them. It's not a static thing. Sometimes at NYU, I ask my students on the exam, I give them a trick question, which is if you were making one of those packages, a time capsule that would be buried under a cornerstone in a new building, what materials would you put in there? And 100 years later, what would you pull out? And if you put your external hard drive in there, it would be, you know, some metal and... but I doubt if in 100 years there would be anything much that you could get out of it.
There's, in terms of just going to the web, there is a research organization, the Image Permanence Institute in Rochester, New York, IPI. And if you Google them, they have a great website, by the way, lots and lots of information on the preservation of media, including and primarily photographic, but not only photographic media. But they have a whole section on digital materials as well. And you might find that as a good starting place. They may not answer that question exactly, but they'll provide you with a strong bibliography and other links. Because there is information, there are individuals who are expert in this area.
What is it called, please?
The Image Permanence Institute in Rochester, New York.
I know there are a couple of other questions, but I think we have to stick time and call this to a close. So I would like very much to thank our two speakers, Debra and Nora. And also Zaina, who's sitting in the audience, who has spoken, but should really be up here. And I would also like very much to thank the team at the New York University Research Institute, who puts on these events almost two or three a day, in fact. They're a fantastic team. They're all outside somewhere mainly, they work tirelessly for these.
And lastly,
the translators, who are sitting in that strange box behind the projection. And lastly, the most pleasant of all announcements, there are food and beverages in the hallway outside, and we invite you to please join us and can carry on the conversation outside. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.